Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today for our seminar in Ukrainian studies at the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute. My name is Emily Channel Justice, and I'm the director of the Temerty Contemporary Ukraine program here at HURI. And I'm really delighted today to have with us Maria Sonevytsky, who is an ethnomusicologist, which is adjacent to my own field of anthropology, I would say. And I hope that in this little introduction, you won't mind indulging me with a small anecdote, which is just about how I met Maria a few years ago at the Soyuz Symposium, which is a small kind of conference for anthropologists and related fields working in the field of kind of post-Soviet cultural studies. And the theme of that particular symposium was performance studies. Kind of more just a really interesting engagement with music, with art. And it was a little outside of my realm. I study mostly political movements. And for the most part, I had been a little skeptical of this kind of performance studies turn because I like music and I like art, but I don't really need to feel like that I have to think about it more deeply sometimes, right? And Maria's paper, which was about authentyczny holos, which is the type of singing that if you were in TCUP's book club, you read about in her excellent book, Wild Music, Sound and Sovereignty in Ukraine. And instead of making me feel like I had to think about art in a way that was more political, she sort of showed how these artistic practices made us think about politics and sovereignty in a way that I had never considered. And I have to really say that it changed the way I thought about the field of ethnomusicology. It changed kind of the way I look at how art and music help us see something new that we couldn't see before. And in the context of Ukraine, this is actually, I think, really essential, a really important perspective. And so I'm really happy to see so many of you here with us to listen to this lecture. And I hope that all of you who joined our book club this month also learned a lot. I really, it's one of my favorite recent books about Ukraine that I've read. It's really spectacular. And all the extra supplemental materials and videos and getting to listen to music and stuff, it's just great. So we'll do some of that today in this talk. The talk is entitled Sharovarshchyna, Sonic Contestations of Ukrainian Wildness, which Maria will explain in just a very brief introduction. Maria Sonevytsky is assistant professor of ethnomusicology at the University of California at Berkeley. I mentioned her book, Wild Music, Sound and Sovereignty in Ukraine, which came out in 2019 with Wesleyan University Press, and it received the Lewis Lockwood First Book Award from the American Musicological Society in 2020. And she's doing research on all sorts of other interesting things, including a short book about Vopli Vodoplyasa. Sorry, Vito, I practiced it and I knew I would mess it up anyway.
You can just say Veve. Just Veve, it's fine.
Veve, there we go, thank you. And she's also developing a longer project on Soviet children's music in the Ukrainian SSR. So thank you so much, Maria, for being with us. Thank you to our audience. We'll have a Q&A at the end where you'll be able to either submit your questions via the chat or you can use the raise hand function and we can call on you. But please do hold your questions in the end. And I'm turning it over to Maria. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for that very warm introduction. It's a total pleasure to be here today. And I have so much gratitude to Emily Channel Justice for creating the TCUP Book Club and showcasing my book this month. I also want to shout out Megan Duncan Smith and Christina Conroy for their support in making this hopefully go smoothly today. So it's been a real thrill to see people engaging with the book and even sometimes tweeting about it. I'm mostly shy on Twitter, but it reminded me that, like with every technology, it really depends how you engage it. So thank you for that reminder that it can be something other than a cesspool. Today, I'm going to talk about Sharovarshchyna, which I will also spend a lot of time trying to define. I will argue that Sharovarshchyna is a slippery term to define because it overlaps with equally unstable concepts such as authenticity and inauthenticity, folklore and fake lore, and because of this, no one wishes to identify themselves or their work with Sharovarshchyna. Rather, artists strive to distance themselves from it. So for those of you who have read the book, you'll notice that I'm picking up on a theme that does already exist within wild music. But I'm trying to make a new argument today about how resurgent area studies paradigms, no matter how trendy or useful for certain historically marginalized communities, continue to excise liminal spaces, such as Ukraine, from their purview. And I'm really grateful to the editors of the forthcoming Anti-Atlas Towards a Critical Area Studies for encouraging me to think more about Sharovarshchyna in terms that might be legible to critical area studies. So I will admit that in preparing today's talk, I struggled a little bit to imagine the audience, since I know that this will also be on YouTube and accessible to everyone. So I do hope that even if you've read the entirety of the book, that there will be something new to chew on today. And if you're new to the topic, I hope there will be enough here to keep you interested. So I will look forward to your questions in the Q&A. And here we go. Here we go. Okay. Where is Sharovarshchyna? I admit this is a bit of a strange question, but in Ukrainian, the suffix shchina often denotes a place. It is perhaps most commonly used to describe regions. Lemkivshchina in the far west spills over into Poland and Slovakia. Poltavshchina is the heartland just east of Kyiv. Luhanshchina lies in the fractured east, and so on. In this usage, the suffix demarcates a concrete territory, but it can also be used to delimit more conceptual terrain. Panshchina referred to the feudal political economic order by which serfs paid labor dues to their landlords. The term Azadovshchina arose in the 1990s to describe a flagrant regime of corruption, specifically the use of tax investigations to silence political enemies and curtail freedoms of the press, that flourished during Mykola Azarov's tenure as head of the state tax administration. The suffix appears not only in Ukrainian, but also in Russian and other Slavic languages. Zhdanovshchina was used, for example, to describe the post-war Soviet cultural policy introduced by Andrei Zhdanov, a member of the Politburo and Central Committee secretary, whose bifurcated view of the world pitted virtuous Soviet culture against the decadent bourgeois expressions of the non-communist world, adding further chill to the onset of the Cold War. So in contemporary Ukrainian usage, the suffix shchina is as likely to refer to zones of abstraction as it is to concretely territorialized places. So where does Sharovarshchyna begin? The term Sharovarshchyna itself derives from sharovare, the billowy silken pants originally developed for ease in riding by Persian horsemen, which were by the 16th century integrated into the wardrobe of the Ukrainian kozaki, the freemen who lived in the quote wild field or dike pole of the Ukrainian steppe, and are often celebrated in Ukrainian historiography for their struggle to establish the first autonomous Ukrainian state. According to a wonderful 2017 article written by the cultural studies scholars Victoria Yermolaeva and Yulia Nikishenko, evidence exists to suggest that the discourse of Sharovarshchyna had already started to coalesce in the late 19th century as critics responded to the recurrence of certain national tropes on the theatrical stage. While the term itself does not seem to have appeared at this time, the critique was already taking form. So Yermolaeva and Nikishenko write, Sharovarshchyna appeared when peasant and Cossack themes began to be used so often in the theater that they became banal. And at the end of the 19th century, this banality did not keep pace with the modern trends of La Belle Époque. But Yermolaeva and Nikishenko identify Soviet atrocities, such as the mass execution of Banduristy in Kharkiv in the 1930s, which led to the development and new hegemony of the concert bandura and other related cultural policy practices, such as the standardization of ethno-national costumes, including prominently Sharovare, And the stylization of genres, including musical genres. So all of these are, according to Yermolaeva and Nikishenko, fundamental acts that contributed to making these billowing pants so emblematic of a kind of monolithic, kitschy, and picturesque Ukrainianness that they entered into the lexicon as Sharovarshchyna. They write, "We begin with the example of Sharovarshchyna, in which the replacement of authentic folk costumes with pseudo-folk was only one of the elements of the cultural policies of the Soviet Union. In post-war film, for example, where the themes of the Ukrainian village, folklore, peasant life become transformed to a large degree into kitsch." So no longer simply representing warriors of the pre-modern Ukrainian wild field, the glimmering crimson pants became symbolic of daredevil male dancing in state-sanctioned song and dance troupes. Today, many Ukrainians would agree, Sharovarshchyna thrives in Soviet legacy institutions such as the Virsky Ballet or the Veryovka National Song and Dance Ensemble pictured here, which present regional Ukrainian songs and dances in a frictionless, highly professionalized, and stylized medley. We might locate Sharovarshchyna then as a hotly contested conceptual regime grounded in territorialized regional cultural symbols of affiliation and rurality. When these regional symbols are manipulated to become emblematic of an undifferentiated nation, it is this very process, according to many Ukrainian scholars and commentators, it is the process of regional symbolic juxtaposition, the process of eliding local and regional differences that results in an often saccharine representation of Ukrainianness that marks Sharovarshchyna as a uniquely Ukrainian iteration of what might otherwise be familiar to some of us as, quote, fake lore or pseudo-folkloric kitsch, as it is often described. Sharovarshchyna is also often spoken about as a relic of Soviet cultural policy, marking a kind of illusory or false patriotism in post-Soviet Ukraine, in which the image of the happy Ukrainian peasant of Soviet times continues to be circulated and reinforced in both Ukraine and its various diasporas. So without dwelling too long on what the term fake lore could possibly mean, I simply want to point out, as many scholars have before me, including Regina Bendix in the important book In Search of Authenticity, that the very concept of fake lore presupposes its opposite. In the original formulation, this opposite would have been folklore, which would have been understood as the uncontaminated wellspring of authentic national expression. But as many ethnomusicologists and anthropologists have documented, folklore has always been entangled by the homogenizing forces of nationalism and also by commerce and industry. So in response to this perceived double contamination of both fake lore and folklore, alternative terms have arisen in contemporary Ukraine. So as I detailed in chapter 3 of Wild Music, there exists a discourse of authentica, which is meant to mark a more pure pre-colonial form of Ukrainian expressive culture. In other words, authentica is meant to represent the real thing, not its imitation. Authentica practitioners, as opposed to those in the flattened binary of professional fake lore folklore, often struggle to navigate between the pressures of codification and systematization, or what Tim Taylor has called genreification, in which certain practices become standardized and replicable across contexts, and the rival pressures of heterogeneity, where individual agency for expression coexists within the tightly policed boundaries of this purportedly authentic tradition. What interests me in these debates is not to arbitrate relative degrees of purity or contamination. I do not personally subscribe to a belief in any kind of a priori authenticity or wildness or even folk, nor do I feel that it is my role as a scholar to make such determinations. But rather, I wish to observe the discourses that mark competing investments in ideas of authenticity and how they enable or constrain musicians who seek to make different kinds of political claims. So I will submit that the very effort to locate Sharovarshchyna is as much an attempt to distance oneself from it, often through strategies of ridicule or condescension, and it is these discursive moves and their political capacities that most interest me. So, moving on. In contemporary usage, Sharovarshchyna is deployed to call out the superficial and indiscriminate mixing of regional folkloric symbols, often which are the same overused symbols codified in state-sanctioned cultural expressions of the Soviet era. Vlad Trebunya, also known as the Hutzul punk impresario Moch, explained the term in the following way. This is my translation, by the way. The term Sharovarshchyna has a negative meaning. That's the term we apply to culture of a low quality, which speculates on national motifs. It was especially active in developing and being cultivated by the government in Soviet times. The motivations of the regime were understandable. On one hand, complete control over creativity. On the other, throw a bone to those who still want to hear, see, and create his or her native art. Today's times are different. Ukraine is independent. There is no control over creativity. Nevertheless, Sharovarshchyna, as the unprincipled Hutzuls sing, lives and flourishes. So coming at this topic from my disciplinary vantage in ethnomusicology, I'm professionally obligated to state the following perhaps overly obvious point. Musical sounds have been especially fertile sites for such contestations over what is or isn't Sharovarshchyna, especially when musicians successfully market their music for audiences outside of Ukraine. Vocal timbres, yawps, yelps that index the mythical village, horns, hammered dulcimers, or drums not found in a conventional orchestra or rock band, costumes that draw on and often exaggerate traditional garb, all of this may or may not enter into the subjective, shifting, contentious zone of Sharovarshchyna. Most Ukrainian musicians who draw on territorialized sonic tropes must navigate through the terrain of Sharovarshchyna, fending off interpretations of their work as pseudo-patriotic folklore. So perhaps we can locate Sharovarshchyna by the distance artists and critics mark between their aspirations for the representational force of their creative works as representative of Ukraine and this most damning allegation of pseudo-Ukrainian inauthenticity. The image at the top of this slide shows a characteristic depiction of what came to be known in the Soviet Union as Druzhba Narodyov, or friendship of the peoples, in which national differences would elide under the flag of communism. Friendship of the peoples became a conventional form of display for Soviet song and dance ensembles, in which Ukrainian peoples were inevitably represented through musical reference to something like the hopak, a kind of quintessential dance tune, and sartorial references to kozaki, quaint peasantry, and highly conventionalized femininities and masculinities. The appearance of Ukrainian folklore in the context of the Druzhba Narodyov can be understood as a widely iterated form of Sharovarshchyna. And so I want to show you now one brief clip from a 2015 performance that is literally titled Druzhba Narodyov, Druzhba Narodov actually, because this took place in Russia. So a few things to point out here. Because this is a recent performance, this should really attune us to just the persistence of these entrenched tropes. The performance occurred in Russia, where the Ukrainian pair of dancers follows a pair that I believe is meant to represent Russian dancers. In the Ukrainian pair, the male dancer will wear a bright blue pair of sharovare, and the woman is adorned in the highly stylized woman's folk costume. Later in the piece, we see representations of many other former Soviet nationalities, although we won't watch that far today. And I also just want to point out in advance how absolutely happy these dancing people appear. So we also see these resonances even of kind of Soviet happiness, the promise of socialist utopia. The Ukrainian dancers here will enter just a few seconds into the clip on the heels of the Russian pair, and then we'll just see them through to the next pair. Okay. But besides these Soviet legacy instantiations, contemporary Sharovarshchyna takes many other forms. The aforementioned scholars Yermolaeva and Nikishenko identify Mikhailo Poplavsky, the heavily decorated singer who was also a lauded prominent Soviet artist, as a celebrity who has continued to capitalize on tropes of Sharovarshchyna in post-Soviet Ukraine well into the 21st century. I would like to show you a 1 minute clip of Poplavsky's song Salo, which extols the exceptional qualities of this iconic Ukrainian snack of pig fat, which is often cured or smoked, and often also paired with horilka or vodka. So we're gonna watch the first minute and a half or so of Salo just through the first chorus. I'm not gonna offer a word by word translation of the text here, but for the non-Ukrainian speakers in the audience, what you mostly need to know is that the repeated refrain celebrates nashe ridne salo, our native lard or pig fat, invites the audience to pour another, and describes how the soul sings when drinking and eating salo. In the verse, our protagonist describes all of the ways in which he loves salo so much that he sleeps on it and would consider bathing in it.
Повела від села і до села, де цвіте картопля на городі, де українське сало завжди в моді. Сало їм на салі сплю, бо я так його люблю. От як більше салом укривався, то як сир у маслі би я купався. Ой, 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 і до душі припало, ой, 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 і наше рідне сало, ой, ой, закуски кращої немає, гей, наливай, душа співає, ой, 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 і наше рідне сало, ой, 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 тебе не буде мало, ой, ой, з тобою наш народ гуляє, гей, душа співає.
Okay, so this is pretty quintessential village kitsch, and I'm offering it here as a paradigmatic example of post-Soviet Sharovarshchyna, with thanks again to Yermolaeva and Nikishenko. No matter its temporal invocations, the Soviet, the post-Soviet, the pre-Soviet, Sharovarshchyna traffics in ideas of what I have previously termed wildness, that is, in discourses of the exotic, rural, unknown or understudied sounds and expressive forms of Ukraine, which is itself a quintessential borderland country so often depicted as wild, teetering on the threshold of East and West. And I'll say more about this at the end of the talk. So if Sharovarshchyna traffics in ideas of wildness, however, it tires them out by rehashing the most worn out tropes of territorialized identity. Sharovarshchyna then should be understood as a representational regime that domesticates heterogeneous and heterophonic gestures of wildness by trapping them in the box of essentialized national culture. I'm pretty proud of that animation. Two of post-Soviet Ukraine's most visible musical exports in Western Europe, Ruslana, who won the Eurovision Song Contest in 2004 with a song called Wild Dances, and Dacha Bracha, the ethno-chaos band who have become darlings of the lucrative world music markets in Western Europe and North America, have fended off accusations of Sharovarshchyna. Ruslana's repackaging of sonic gestures from Hutsulshchina, the territory of the Carpathian Mountains in Western and Southern Ukraine, led her to triumph in the annual pageant of Gussied-up geopolitics that is the Eurovision Song Contest in 2004. Dacha Bracha emerged years later from the hip world of Kievan experimental theater and takes a somewhat more reserved, yet cartographically more expansive approach to hybridizing regional sounds. Anyone who has heard these two performers, and we will listen to clips shortly, would likely agree that an aesthetic gulf separates them, yet neither group could fully inoculate themselves from charges of Sharovarshchyna, that their use of regional sounds is somehow exploitative or superficial or haphazard. So in a moment, we will examine the attack on Ruslana's wild dances by Western Ukrainian intellectuals in the journal Haletsky Correspondent. But first, I wanted just to show an excerpt of her 2004 Eurovision Song Contest performance of Wild Dances. This is the performance that won that year. I'd ask you to note that the song begins with the visual and sonic cue of the trembita, the iconic alpine horn of the Hutsul people. It then shifts gears into a much more conventional style of Europop, with repeated shouts of hey, choreographed dance moves, and fairly generic English language lyrics, such as I want you to want me, juxtaposed against Hutsul vocables, so non-semantic syllables such as shidi, ridi, dana, etc. Okay, so we'll just watch a brief clip here. Uh-oh. In the book, I have lots more to say about the gendered performance here. Ruslana was compared to Xena the warrior princess and soon after embraced her identity as an Amazonka appealing to an ancient Scythian archetype of female warriors. I also write about the reception of the song by various constituencies within Ukraine, including the very Hutsuls from which Ruslana claimed to have drawn inspiration and who reacted in a variety of ways, sometimes surprising ways to me, to the stereotype of Hutsul wildness that she had so successfully repackaged in the language of Eurovision pop. And I'm happy to talk more about that in the Q&A since it's a little bit beyond the scope here, since the Hutsuls themselves weren't likely to invoke the term Sharovarshchyna, at least in the conversations that I had. So I want to say that the reception of this song was complex on the ground and continues to morph as time passes. But I want to linger on one discussion precisely about whether this performance was Sharovarshchyna. This took place again in Haletsky Correspondent, and I'm going to focus on the words of the writer Yurko Izdrik, a well-known poet and essayist based in the Western Ukrainian town of Kalush. He wrote about Sharovarshchyna as a particularly Ukrainian iteration of a broad cross-cultural identifying code. This is my translation again. Though so-called Sharovarshchyna belongs to culture, it is not itself a full-worth cultural phenomenon. It is rather a cultural code, an identifying code. This is the code that puts a substantial part of identity on the nation bearer and performs a representative function. It is an original calling card of the nation for emergence into the world. In this sense, Sharovarshchyna is no different from similar codes of other nations. Tsekhanshchina, Russian matryoshka caviar vodka, Argentine tango, French chanson, Latin lovers, etc. However, Izdrik believes that the Ukrainian identifying code is in, quote, a sorry state due to its contamination by previous generations of folklorizing discourses. So Izdrik, who identified the Ruslana as the current paragon of the lamentable continuation of Sharovarshchyna from Soviet times, he goes on to identify her as such. I don't know how it seems to the miner from Donetsk, but to me, for example, it is very hard to identify myself with the pederastic youth in raspberry colored pants with their sadomaso bracelets, their oseledits, that's the quintessential Cossack hairstyle, the chub of a single forelock on the top of the head, doing some cosmopolitan dance move in the background of the national deputy to Ukraine, the winner of some kind of Eurovision, Ruslana Lezhichko. Now then, here's the definition. Sharovarshchyna, this is a kind of lezhichka. And it should be noted that this was written at a time when Ruslana was, in fact, briefly a representative to the Ukrainian parliament. Istik shrewdly manipulates the pop star's rarely used last name, Lezhichko, into a neologism that redefines Sharovarshchyna for post-Soviet times. So by equating the then most prominent contemporary purveyor of Ukrainian ethno-national pop rock with Sharovarshchyna, Istik eulogizes the state of expressive culture in Ukraine. But Ruslana herself rejected the characterization that equated her wild dances and her broader Hutsulian project to the banality of Sharovarshchyna. She responded to critics by explaining, quote, "We turned to ethnos, not to Sharovarshchyna. I am a contemporary singer with ethnic interests who has seen ethnic material through fresh eyes." Ruslana's defense here makes a few critical moves. First, she invokes ethnos, the term used by early Soviet ethnographers and continues today to be widely used, to identify, historicize, and in the Soviet context, to foment revolutionary consciousness among discrete populations. So the use of the term ethnos signals a kind of scientific legitimacy. And this is further bolstered in other places, not in this little fragment, by her defense on the basis of her own expertise as a trained folklorist and her consultations with professional ethnomusicologists based in Lviv, some of whom were her friends when they were students together at the Lviv Conservatory of Music. Finally, she asserts her privileges as a contemporary singer. The use of contemporary here implicitly rejects that this is a nostalgic or backwards looking project. And in fact, her earliest work on the Hutsulian project, which eventually grew into Wild Dances, went to great pains to underscore the various cutting edge sound, film, and computer technologies and the international teams that contributed to making of her to the making of her first mega clip, Znayu Ya, music video. That video even opens with a scene of Ruslana searching the internet for clues about the Hutsuls, again, situating the singer squarely in the digitalized present. So we can compare this example to Dacha Bracha, the world music band who have made real inroads to North American, Western European, and other lucrative world music markets with the music that they describe as ethno-chaos. I'm going to play a little fragment here from a 2015 performance for KEXP, which is a popular indie alt-rock station in Seattle. And since then, I will just say that they've been featured again on KEXP in 2020 in their newer costumes. But I just want to get these sounds in your ears. You'll hear a clip of Shtoz Pod Duba, which was the opening track on their first album, Yahutke, released in 2007. The basic track develops, as many of their tracks do, over a cello ostinato, a repeated figure, with percussion, a floor tom, and a djembe drum on a stand, and minimal accordion accompaniment. The lyrics use naturalistic metaphors that are typical of many rural repertoires and that suggest a domestic dispute or conflict. The text opens by asking what is under the oak tree, under its roots. Under the roots, there is water, and Ivanko leads his horse to drink there, but the horse doesn't drink. So Ivanko beats him on the head. And then in the last stanza, it suddenly turns into a first person narration, the voice of the narrator, who asks, "Don't beat me, I will go along on this adventure." The lyrics are sung by the women in the band in often close harmony with rhythmic, aggressive, toasting style vocables performed by Marko Halanevich. So we'll just listen to a little bit of this here.
Radha Bracha from Free Ukraine.
Free Ukraine.
Bobby, 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 Bob
Okay. So there's a lot to say about this potentially. I'm just going to highlight one thing. So in the book, I developed this idea of sound marks of sovereignty, ways that Dacha Bracha is creatively indexing specific regional traditions to say something about Ukrainian legitimacy. And what I want to point to here in particular is the use of vocal timbre, so the actual vocal quality of sound, which is very much in dialogue with these ideas about authentica, and set in opposition to a kind of heavily folklorized, stylized vocal style. This is highly contested territory. There are authentica practitioners who believe that Dacha Bracha are actually guilty of prolonging this kind of folklorism or this fake lore. And on the other hand, there are people who, especially Western audiences, who impute to Dacha Bracha a kind of deep rural authenticity, which is in so many ways reminiscent of the kind of discourse that surrounded the quote-unquote mystery of Bulgarian women's voices, which Donna Buchanan writes about so expertly in her book Performing Democracy, and that took place in the 1980s and 90s, which again just goes to show us that things come back around. So In a 2019 interview with the members of Dacha Bracha, a journalist for the Ukrainian media organization Hromadske TV asked them what differentiates their music from Sharovarshchyna. Marko Halanevich, one of the band members, responded confidently, "Dacha Bracha begins where Sharovarshchyna ends," he said. The interviewer pushed him to clarify, and Halanevich elaborated a bit, explaining, quote, "Sharovarshchyna is not just a stylistic marker of something, but a worldview on that marker," end quote. The other band members began to chime in to explain the perils of Sharovarshchyna. The problem, they say, is when one believes that, quote, "Ukrainians are the best, that our song is inimitable in the world," end quote. When there's a lack of moderation in using local sounds, or in band member Nina Haranetska's words, the cellist and singer, when a performance feels, quote, "the need to show everything at once, as much as possible," end quote. Halanevich goes on to explain that a particular kind of attunement to the world, a balanced approach to demonstrating the uniqueness of Ukrainian culture that is also in sync with the contemporary world, is what makes him confident that Dacha Bracha is not Sharovarshchyna. The band members begin to joke that given the oversized hats, shapki, that are part of their visual brand, perhaps they have introduced Shapkivshchina to Ukraine. Or perhaps, another band member offers, what they offer is wholly uncharted territory, for which she proposes the term Dachabrachivshchina. These funny twists on the idea of Sharovarshchyna are distancing maneuvers, acknowledging the existence of the zone of Sharovarshchyna, but defining oneself as being outside of it. In both of the examples I've presented, Ruslana and Dacha Bracha, there is an attempt to locate Sharovarshchyna, either to equate it to the perceived inauthenticity of the Lizhichka, or to question how the bricolaging of regional sound marks appears distinct from the superficiality of Sharovarshchyna. In both cases, artists respond by refusing the question altogether, suggesting that there are more redemptive paradigms of authenticity at play. For Ruslana, this is grounded in what she claims to be her rigorous research, her fieldwork. For Dacha Bracha, it is in their anti-exceptionalism and their aesthetic integrity. In both cases, the artists refuse Sharovarshchyna as a form of pseudo-patriotism, while maintaining their own patriotism as Ukrainian artists who are centering and championing Ukrainian music outside of Ukraine. So, towards the conclusion here, and I will say that this is an image from 2014, so right as the annexation of Crimea was occurring, and this is taken from the Financial Times. The dilemma of Ukraine's in-betweenness has defined its political culture for centuries, and especially since the fall of the USSR. Its ambiguous status vis-a-vis geopolitical centers and peripheries has been perhaps most vociferously argued by scholars who debate whether Ukraine is post-colonial or not, sometimes by projecting this question 1,000 years or more back into history. Furthermore, as Alexei Yurchak, the anthropologist of Russia, has recently argued, intellectual trends in critical area studies towards carving the world into a global north and a global south, quote, reproduces multiple liberal distortions that relegate the history of world socialism to an inconsequential aberration in the history of liberal capitalism, end quote. Yurchak points out that Russia does not fit into either the global north or global south. He writes, quote, its past and present are rendered invisible by this terminology, end quote. So I'm gonna make a move here, which is similar to another one that I made in the book, and suggest that Ukraine is perhaps one step further displaced from this, because it has been and continues today to be provincialized by Russia. We see a resurgent discourse, right, of Malorossiya in Ukraine today. While, like the Russia Yurchak describes, it also defies the binary parsing of the world into north or south, east or west. It is the very fact of Ukraine's persistent liminality, of its unsettled border status, of its historical narratives that are so overdetermined by outsiders, of its easy elision into Russia when politicians and pundits reduce the Soviet Union to Russia, of the fact that it was largely excluded from the knowledge production paradigms of Cold War area studies, that allows wildness as a representational resource in Ukrainian culture to flourish today. Urban musicians who auto-exoticize through the incorporation of rural musical gestures that invoke the exotic lure of wildness are especially susceptible to accusations that they widen the domain of Sharovarshchyna. But Ukrainian musicians still persistently return to regional or local sound markers for inspiration. Sharovarshchyna, I'm arguing, allows for these sonic contestations of wildness to occur. For those who seek to carve out a space in international music markets, marking their territory as unique and worthy is of paramount importance, and sonic gestures of wildness offer one enticing path towards establishing this significance. So, two concluding thoughts here. The first is that these artists attempt to deprovincialize Ukraine by reprovincializing Ukrainian sounds. By mining provincial sound marks as source material, these musicians follow a somewhat paradoxical route towards deprovincializing Ukraine. And the second point is that musical self-orientalization, or to play on Larry Wolf's formulation in The Invention of Eastern Europe, which is a book that was very helpful to me as I was formulating my core ideas in the book. So to play on Larry Wolf's idea, this would be self-demi-orientalization. He makes the case that Eastern Europe was never quite orientalized, but it was in this stage of demi-orientalization. So musical self-demi-orientalization becomes not a strategy of resistance so much as a technology of self-legitimation, of sovereignty. Amplifying sounds that evoke Ukrainian wildness and accepting the risk that they might be perceived as further expanding the zone of Sharovarshchyna is actually a musical method of centering Ukraine, of claiming that this liminal space occupies a legitimate place on the map. Thank you. Dziękuję. I am eager for your questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Maria. That was, I think, a great way of drawing on what you talk about in the book and expanding the way that we're thinking about it. And thanks also for the musical illustrations. I think that's really helpful too. So for our audiences, if you're on the webinar, please feel free to use the raise hand function if you want to ask a question, or you can send me a message in the chat. And if you're watching on YouTube or on Facebook, you are welcome to send your question in there and it'll get to me as well. I will use my position as moderator to start the questions off, and I have many questions, and I will focus on, I think I'll pick one for now. One of the things I was thinking about here, because the discussion of kitsch, I think, is really interesting, because there's also this move in anthropology and performance studies to think about kitsch in not just a way of a way of naming something that we don't like and we don't want to be a part of, right? There's also a kind of embrace kitsch. And I recently published an edited volume about LGBT experiences in the region. And one of the chapters in there by Carlos Verdens and Janis Ozolinč is about two gay male performers in Latvia who precisely straddle the line of kitsch and camp to kind of create this rural space of LGBT performance. And I thought that that line, and they do a great job. I mean, they have a whole kind of, you know, engagement with this line of kitchen camp that I think is really helpful. But I just think it's, I wanted to see if you think these artists are doing that, if they're using kitsch. I mean, the first video that you showed, the solo video, is so kitschy in I think the way that we can mock really easily, but, you know, is there a move toward a kind of embrace of kitsch or a kind of shift toward camp that is more easily digestible because it's making a kind of commentary or a mockery on some of these things? Is there any play with some of those moves?
That's a really great question, and I appreciate it so much. I feel like you've just invoked the figure of Virka Serdyuchka, who is obviously so missing from this talk, and I could have probably made the whole talk just about Virka. So yeah, kitsch and camp are really useful analytics to be thinking about here. And one of the things I've always appreciated from Sontag's original formulation of camp is that it has to be unknowing, right? It has to be kind of unconscious of its own campiness in order to rise to the criteria of camp that Sontag defines. So the other term I would throw into the mix that it also doesn't appear in this talk, but makes a few appearances in the book, is stjob, which is this particular form of Soviet absurdist humor, right? That just goes all the way sort of past this kind of ironic distancing towards a very knowing, a very purposeful form of satire. And I often think especially if you're coming at this without a knowledge of Soviet materials, Dominic Boyer and Alexei Yurchak wrote a really wonderful article some years ago comparing Stephen Colbert's original iteration on Comedy Central, where he was basically performing as though he were a far right or conservative pundit, kind of reality TV person, as a form of American stjob, basically. So just as a reference for what I'm talking about here. So yeah, if we look at a figure like Virka Serdyuchka, I think there's no question, right, that Virka Serdyuchka, who is performing these same tropes, right? I could have shown you some of the opening scenes to some of those music videos, which are clearly Sharovarshchyna, but doing so in a very self-knowing way, right? It is very intentionally done for humor. And that does not stop that music from becoming sincerely beloved either, right? Like, I have been to many weddings where Virka Serdyuchka is unironically danced to by people who just think that it's great and fun music. So again, sort of like figuring out, you know, where authenticity is or where sincerity is very tricky, because we all receive things in such complex ways. But I think I might draw a distinction between the kind of self-knowledge about the use of these kitschy tropes or these Sharovarshchyna tropes and a kind of sincere engagement with those things. And honestly, the Poplavsky example makes my head spin a little bit, because I think there has to be a public that consumes that music unironically. I haven't done ethnographic research on those publics, and perhaps I should, because I would actually be really interested in understanding more about those markets and those people. But I know that I've also heard those songs played at Ukrainian weddings, where they're also engaged with and danced with kind of unironically. So I think maybe that's a partway answer to your question, but I agree that these kind of entangled terms that all have their own complex genealogies, and then their very unstable presence on the ground as people engage with different artists, with different songs, with different in different contexts, right? All of that makes it really hard to capture all of them in one 40-minute talk. So, but yeah, thank you for that question. That's great.
Yeah, and thanks for bringing Virka into the conversation, because, you know, that's what that's sometimes what we think of, but obviously there's more. So we have a couple questions from YouTube. I'm gonna call on Jennifer Carroll here, whose hand just went up. And then I think I'm gonna try to kind of combine a couple of questions from our other audiences. So go ahead, Jen, you're welcome to turn off your, or turn on your video too, if you want.
Hi, everybody. So thank you so much for having this this presentation. I love this. More money for the TCUP program, please. I think it's more of a statement than a question. I just want to hear Maria talk more about this idea at the end that I found really interesting of using, of like proactively provincializing something for the sake of deprovincializing something else. And I guess maybe a place to start, what I immediately thought of when you externalize that idea was like the sort of things that are for sale at the Svyi, like on Krasatik, in where it's like you can go in and you can find like hand woven pot holders and really like super modern looking contemporary dress that has like, you know, like historically accurate like embroidery across it or something like that. Or even I've seen cutting boards like for cheeses and apples where they have put into it a wood carving that's this very same sort of like the wreath and the embroidery and the vishivanka and everything. So like is that a sort of a similar phenomenon, or am I being overly simplistic by being like it's also vishivanka, so it must be doing the same political work? But how would we make sense of what you're talking about in the context of lots of other small and large manifestations of a sort of like resurgence of this traditional Ukrainian culture?
Yeah, thanks. It's a great question. And it's one that I think about a lot because there's just no question that there has been a resurgence in so many different arenas that traffics in, in rural tropes. I'm always reluctant personally to diagnose anything as Sharovarshchyna, right? Again, like I, as a diagnostic, I just am not super interested in saying that. And I think when we look at an example like Svyi, which has these like beautiful things, you know, I think it forces us also to think about the class implications here, right? Who is able to purchase these kind of like elevated versions of regional symbolism. And so I would just probably put that into the mix too. But yeah, so this process of this, what I'm identifying as a paradoxical process of attempting to deprovincialize by reprovincializing is both uniquely Ukrainian in this particular iteration and also somewhat of a global phenomenon in many parts of the world. So the kind of process of using regional tropes and hybridizing them with existing genres is something that people have written about in all different kinds of the world, parts of the world. And I'm in fact indebted to Ana Maria Ochoa's thinking specifically in this kind of within the framing of provincializing and deprovincializing and reprovincializing, in addition to obviously Chakrabarty and also Yurchak. So I might return for a moment to the example of Authentica, which is one that really interests me because this is a scene that I have been really inspired by and I have learned a lot from and have personally engaged with as both a practitioner, as a student, and occasionally as a teacher. And so Authentica is exactly one of those locations where the kind of assertion of a return to a pre-Soviet, less contaminated version of folklore is something that is very hard for its practitioners to contend with because they're so aware of the discourses of authenticity and inauthenticity that are at play. At the same time, however, these practitioners are engaging these tropes for the purpose then of popularizing these styles outside of Ukraine. So a lot of Authentica practitioners, maybe not a lot, this is a small scene, right? But the prominent practitioners give workshops internationally. They come to North America sometimes to perform, et cetera, right? So there is a way, there's almost like a, I don't want to use propaganda because that's more charged than what I mean. So there's like a diplomacy at the core of understanding that this is a somewhat false discourse of authenticity, but that it is maybe believed to be more authentic than the alternative. I've really struggled with how to write about it because I'm talking to people who are themselves scholars and who understand the limitations of discourses of authenticity while also acknowledging the strategic use of these discourses for, again, asserting the kind of Ukrainianness of a specific practice. So Jen, I feel like we need to talk more probably. I don't think I really answered your question fully, but it's a really great question, and I will definitely sit with it.
I'd love this answer. So I'm deeply satisfied, even if you're not. Thank you very much.
Okay, never satisfied.
Thanks, Jen. So I'm going to kind of, we have several great questions from our YouTube audience. I'm going to combine just two of them, and then I can combine two of them later, but I want to give a chance to our webinar participants also. So the first part of the question is from Margarita Balmaceda, who is talking more about deprovincializing. She really likes this framework of deprovincializing Ukraine by provincializing sounds. So this is sort of some of what you just talked about, but are there other parallels in areas of art, literary criticism, or even social sciences? I think yes, personally, but let's hear what Maria says. And then we also have a question from Yulian Haida, who is asking, are there situations where Sharovarshchyna is an accusation that is weaponized to totally undercut any attempt at recreating a distinctly Ukrainian cultural expression? What's the role of internalized shame?
Great questions. So to the first point, I think the other person I should have name checked in my little lit review just now was Mayhill Fowler, who actually also uses these framings of provincializing and deprovincializing via Chakrabarty to talk about Ukrainian theater at the turn of the century, which again is related to this talk insofar as we these scholars believe that the discourse of Sharovarshchyna was also intimately tied into the emergence of Ukrainian theatrical traditions. So I definitely think that the theater and that context in Mayhill Fowler's book would be a great place to look at some of those examples. But certainly also in the sartorial realm. I mean, I think the previous question from Jennifer Carroll also made us think, right, about the Vyshyvanka as a kind of counterpart to the Sharovare. You won't walk into Vsi Svoyi and find Sharovare, at least not the last time I was there. Maybe now they have reemerged. If someone knows, I would be interested to know. But but the Vyshyvanka and its prevalence in sort of elevated aesthetic clothing right now. I mean, there's a sort of whole scene, a fashion scene that is using these very provincial, right? This is an urban fashion scene using provincial sartorial tropes, visual tropes to both make Ukrainians proud of these inheritances and also export them, right? I have hanging in my closet a really beautiful example of this that I debated briefly whether I should wear today, you know. So I do think those would be other places certainly to look, and probably in visual art, although I confess that I know less about that. The other question about shame and the internalized shame that can come with this, I think absolutely. And I, you know, Yulian Haida's question really makes me think about how these stylized practices have been naturalized in different diaspora communities as in a very different ideological, under a very different ideological rubric, right? Under one that for the second half of the 20th century was in fact privileging the idea that this was the incubator of true Ukrainianness against the Sovietization or Russification of Ukrainian culture in Soviet Ukraine. So these are really complex dynamics, and the last thing that I want to do is to shame anyone who derives pleasure from participating in stylized folklore, but that would be a question that would be really interesting to try to assess ethnographically, and so that's going to be my answer for now.
Great. We have a hand up from Nazar Kozak, if you would like to go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, thank you. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you, Maria, for your wonderful presentation. And I have a question which relates to the first question and actually your answer to this first question when you mentioned about Berka Serdyuchka as another sort of phenomenon, another shade of Sharovarshchyna on this scale between wildness and fake folklore. How would you situate on this scale such artistic acts as Vopliwi do Plyasova and Braty Gadyukiny, which gain a huge popularity in this rock genre, in which definitely are not considered in Ukraine at least as a sort of Sharovarshchyna? How do you see the criteria that allow us to locate these bands on this scale? And what do you think about such a concept as cultural appropriation as opposition to the use folklore for folklore's sake, I would say?
Yeah, really great question. Thank you so much for that question. So I'm currently supposedly working on a project on Vopli Viduklasova Veve, and specifically on their very first recording, which was the record known as Tansi, which also had the hit song Tansi on it. And Brate Hadyukine are a band I really respect and listen to a lot. So I think one of the, this is a provisional answer, right? But I think in the cases of bands like this, so for those who aren't conversant, these are bands especially associated with the emergence of like a Ukrainian rock or punk scene in the late Soviet period, many which exist today in different forms, but especially thinking about that early stage, and that's what I'll focus on, because I think accounting for Vopli Viduklasova today and Skripka today begs a certain other set of questions around maybe more relevant to what we're talking about today. But when we're thinking about the early period, these were bands that, if they were appropriating anything, they were appropriating Anglo-American rock, right? And Western European rock musics. And so the kind of display, to the extent that there was a display of kind of Ukrainian folkloric tropes, it was a sort of second order concern, I would say. I don't know if you would agree with that. But I think, I typically would characterize those bands as stjobish, really, as sort of engaged in this Soviet genre of highly satirical, ironic performance that's sort of turning Soviet tropes on their head. And the concrete example I will give is from Tansi, which is really was my way into this project, because I just became obsessed with that music video and I couldn't stop watching it. And then someone asked me to write, Fabian Holt invited me to write a short book for the 33 and a third series. And I thought, okay, this will give me a chance to just keep listening and watching this music video. But if you Google the music video for Tansi, what you see is the band, it's a very spare scene, but they have this absurd little flag that they walk around the stage with. And it just says Tansi. And the text is really about going to the klub, the sort of rural village club, and just dancing at the end of a long week. It's this really fun song. And it's using the kind of like pioneer or komsomol imagery to turn it on its head, really, to sort of just poke fun at the kind of absurd rigidity of Soviet official culture. At least that would be my interpretation, and based on conversations with the band members, I think I'm not too far off from what they had intended. They certainly saw it as a huge joke to a degree, right? And so I think maybe it's about the degree to which folkloric tropes are foregrounded. I'm not familiar with Brate Hadyukine, for example, or Vopli Viduklasova of ever really performing in Vyshyvanki or Sharovare, at least not before the 21st century. So I might make the distinction around sort of what is prioritized in the performance.
May I just one replica? What I mean by cultural appropriation, when you listen to Hadyukine, the use of language, this is not normative Ukrainian. It's a sort of Galician. Ukrainian spoke in the villages, very much influenced by Soviet, by Russian elements. And these guys who formed Gadyukine, they were actually not of this local Ukrainian background. From their side, it was clearly sort of appropriating this local lore and trying to build something on this. And in case of Viduklasova, what I think, when after Skripka returned from France, and they probably use this clip Vesna, which use a lot of already Ukrainian elements, it was not, but that time it was not as job as early Tansi. I think it was late 90s. Mm-hmm, yeah. So it was before 21st century. And Skripka like try to do something serious, especially in 2000s already with these festivals of folk music, inviting all these groups. So I would say about Vodoplas was that they have a sort of evolution.
Yes. Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. And in the case of Hadyukin, it was clearly an appropriation, but it was perceived like a sort of authentic thing, like expression of special identity. And when you consider such songs as My Chlopsi z Banderstatu, we are boys from Banderstadt, which is like become a hymn, which is sung by ultra-right football fans. It's turned completely into different things as it was in the beginning, like a job. So I think it's more complex than just a self-irony.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. And I think similarly, you know, with Veve, the choice to sing in Ukrainian when they were at that time Russian speakers, they aren't anymore. But that also was a kind of, it was explained to me by Sasha Pipa and by Oleg Skripka as an opportunity to distinguish themselves from the other rock scene that they were participating in, especially in Russia, right? So the fact that they were singing in Ukrainian was a kind of novelty. And it would be, to return to Yulian Haidar's question, it would be interesting to filter that through this idea of shame potentially there too. So thank you for that. And I would love to be in dialogue in the future.
Thanks for that question. I think we'll all be picking up that book when it comes out. So, okay. Irina Voloshina, you're next if you'd like to come on.
Yes. So I can't start my video for some reason. So I'll just be without a video. Thank you so much. Yeah, I can do that now.
Oh. Hi.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I really, really enjoyed it. Maybe it's a little bit beyond the scope of your book, your research currently, and you've touched a little bit about what I'm trying to ask in the previous questions, but could you please comment a little bit on the differences in understanding and maybe using of the terms Avtantika and Sharovarshchyna in Ukraine and in Ukrainian diasporic communities, maybe in North America? Thank you.
Yeah. So you asked about Avtantika and Sharovarshchyna. Okay, so the first thing I will say is that it's been really exciting to see the development of these Avtantika, I'm just going to use that term, right, of these Avtantika practices taking hold in North American communities. And I've been an active participant in that. So again, I want to just, you know, I just want to claim again that, right, we don't want to shut down these practices or shame anyone who's actively participating in them. When I was speaking with colleagues in Ukraine about Avtantika and the kind of trouble with the Avtantika framing, some of them were really careful to make a distinction between Avtantika, which they were locating specifically in the village, specifically being sung by elders in that village who were sometimes born before the Soviet regime or early in the Soviet regime, and rekonstruktsiya, so the reconstruction of Avtantika, right? So the urban practitioners who were taking these field materials, often the same people who recorded those field materials, and then reworking them into this kind of urban rekonstruktsiya, reconstruction of Avtantika. So I think that's a really helpful way of just demonstrating how this discourse itself is evolving and shifting as practitioners are confronting those limitations. I also just want to point out that, you know, my way into this whole world really is heavily indebted to a singer whose name is Mariana Sadovska, who I was so fortunate to encounter in New York City back in, I think, 1999. And she was coming having done a lot of engagement with exactly these rural singers in rural places. But she was taking a lot of creative license with the interpretation of those works. And so right off the bat, my very first encounter with this was with an artist who really took seriously the source material and a respect for that material, while also being very assertive about the creative potential and the right to continue to play with those materials. And I think that if there is a correct way to think about tradition, right, that it has to be that tradition is never fixed, that it's always changing over time, and it's always defined by its context, and it always has particular stakeholders who are making certain claims. So I haven't encountered the discourse of Sharovarshchyna so much in the diaspora context. I don't know, Irina, if you have, and I would be interested to talk with you about that. But there's no question that some of the imagery I showed today probably reminds us of diaspora ensembles that are performing in these ways. And those are often the places where this authentica hasn't yet appeared, right? So we have examples like Ukrainian Village Voices in New York or the Kosa Collective in Canada, who are kind of incubating these authentica practices. But as far as I know, those practices aren't appearing in the choirs that exist or in the existing dance troupes, right? We're still seeing a very stylized folkloric performance. And so it'll be interesting to see what happens, I think, as this takes on more prevalence. The last thing I'll say, sorry, but this is just a little high horse that I like to get up on occasionally, is that in the diaspora case, people were often, when the sort of authentica style was beginning to appear, people were calling it bili holos, this white voice style, which is meant to suggest, what is it meant to suggest? I think it's meant to suggest a kind of natural, right, unmediated, very pure voice. And I was really cautioned against using that terminology because it is apparently a non-Ukrainian term to describe, and an exoticizing term, in fact, to describe a vocal technique and practice that is highly skilled, right? That is not, in fact, natural in any way, and that is learned and often learned in an immersive context, at least in its original context, by people who just grow up singing in these ways and develop the vocal apparatus so that they can sing in ways that that may sound exciting or exotic, wild to certain audiences, but that are in fact healthy and sort of vernacular indigenous ways of producing the voice. So I just wanted to add that in.
Thanks, Irina. I can't believe we're already running out of time, and I'm absolutely apologetic that we can't get to all the questions. I did want to ask this question from James Brennan that came through YouTube. He's asking, what do you think of Goa, which is Ukraine's Eurovision entry this year? And their video, if you haven't seen it, uses all this Chernobyl imagery. I would like to add a little bit onto that question and ask about the controversy surrounding their entry, because of course they replaced Maru, which is a band or a musician who refused to cancel concerts in Russia and therefore was replaced by this other Ukrainian band. I'd be very curious to hear your take on all of the politics surrounding Eurovision in Ukraine this year.
I should have anticipated this question more than I did. And I actually feel like Irina Voloshina might have a better answer than I do. But what I will say really quickly is that when I first watched the Goa clip, I really enjoyed it. I mean, I think that they're doing something really interesting and provocative and using not only kind of celebratory stereotypes of Ukrainianness, but also the most negative stereotypes of Ukrainianness, right? So what I often say to North American students is that if you've ever heard of Ukraine, it's likely through the Chernobyl catastrophe, right? Many Americans' awareness of Ukraine, despite everything that's happened in the last few years, often still remains sort of there. So I actually think that what they're doing is a really interesting extension of the growing scene in especially urban spaces in Ukraine that is further developing these kind of ethnomusica tropes. They are using a spring calling song. They're using a sort of, you know, authentica material. They're using the vocal timbres that index of authentica again. And then they're juxtaposing it and integrating it with these electronic textures and this kind of post-apocalyptic post-nuclear sort of visual imagery. So I think that's really interesting. In terms of the controversy, I have unsettled thoughts about this myself. And so I think I might just answer by not answering there because I don't want to plant a flag anywhere specifically. But I will say that I think that that Goa has a fighting chance for Eurovision this year. So I will sort of place my bets there.
I think that's the perfect answer. And I would also encourage all of you, you know, just this conversation about Eurovision is very a small snippet of the kind of ways that we can look into the politics of Eurovision that is really interesting and just isn't, Ukraine is not alone in having a lot of political influence in terms of Eurovision. At any rate, we're actually a minute over time. I'm really sorry to those of you whose questions we didn't get to. I do really recommend reading Maria Sonevytsky's excellent book to learn more about what she talked about today, especially the concept of wildness. She also addresses Sharovarshchyna a little bit more, although this framing is like she said, different than how it's used in the book. And I really thank everybody for coming. Thanks for your great questions. Thank you so much for this wonderful lecture. I also popped a couple of videos in the chat for anybody who wants to go down a rabbit hole for the rest of the afternoon. Let me just make a very quick announcement, which is next week's seminar in Ukrainian studies, which will also take place here streaming on YouTube, I believe, at April 7th, 12 o'clock noon to 1:15. It's called A Tale of Two Piedmonts, Cross-Border Communist Movements and Weaponized Nationalism in the Polish-Soviet Borderlands, 1921 to 1939, which is a lecture by Marcel Garbos. So I think that will be of interest to a lot of you here. So let's thank Maria Sonevytsky one more time, and thanks to everybody for joining us today.
And thank you everyone for being here today. Really appreciate it, and for the wonderful questions. And